All right, folks, jumping right into action. As far as keeping an update, like last time, what's going on in politics and whatnot. So I figure I'd do a round two, like I did in the beginning with Obama and Hillary and John McCain and Palin and all the rest, giving prophecy along the way, like last time, prophecy along the way. So I already pretty much spoke. Well, no, actually, a new revelation came. Like I said, God steady, he steady pointed, he steady left, right, because you know that people are taking heed of what's being said, and the seeds are being planted. You know, I'm the soil. I'm going about planting seeds, and he bringing light to what I'm saying, and I'm sure a lot of you witnessing, and it's coming to a light on the things I've been speaking about. So that's why I keep sharing more, and I just don't hear other places as well to educate people as much as possible, as much as I can. So, but getting right to it, let's see. What to start first? That is number one, Rick Santorum and Michelle Bachmann, bomb Iran. You people are insane. Here's the thing, folks. If you go over there, see this what Ahmadinejad wants. He wants America to go to war with him. See, he done purchased a lot of new weapons that these spies and journalists constantly coming over to Iran trying to peek or trying to infiltrate Iran, and they also looking for that as well, seeing if they gonna catch American spies. But like I said, they infiltrating, they looking for this. They looking, you know, try to catch some or whatnot, because they already know that America is going to be curious on what's going on with Iran. But their missiles are underground. Of course, they're not going to have nuclear activity above ground. They have it underground, where it's out of sight. So, just give you a heads up. Revelation. Revelation. But yeah, but like I said, Ahmadinejad wants America to go to war. He's been wanting this for the longest, ever since the Bush term. When Bush was in office, and Bush was, you know, first he went to war in Iraq, then he was trying to switch over to Iran. Remember, explained this before. And all of a sudden, Bush yielded because he see the Iranian president was actually serious about launching a nuke over in the direction of America. So that's why Bush was like, whoa, you know what? Let's leave him alone, change the subject. Back to Iraq. You know, let's leave him alone. Let's leave Iran alone. So, this whole idea, yeah, I'm getting tangled, but this whole idea of trying to bomb Iraq is foolish because, I mean, not Iraq, but Iran. Because that's what this guy wants. He's been wanting this for the longest because he want to test out his weapons that he has bought. He want to test them out. He has weapons of mass destruction over there, and he wants to test. Really, he wants to test it out on Israel. That's who he really targeting first. He want to get rid of Israel, but since America is allies with Israel, then that's what a problem. But right now, you know, as far as me keeping up on updates, it's been kind of issues with that. That Obama been kind of resistant to be allies with Israel. Because Obama knows the consequence of being allies with Israel. Because, okay, how can I put this? Obama knows the consequence of being allies with Israel because the Iranian president, because his threats toward Israel and how he plans to get rid of Israel just as well as America. And if you watch on here a clip on YouTube where Iranian president made a threat and he said if America meddles one more time, and I also remember reading in the newspaper where he says one more time America has to meddle in the Middle East. So it sounds like Obama, I mean Ahmadinejad putting his foot down saying, hey, we sick and tired of all this meddling, mind your business in the West, let the East be the East and the West be the West. So you come over here one more time, it's about to go down. So I guess this was Santorum and Bachmann, they feel like they are the superheroes. Like we, if I'm president, we gonna bomb them folks. Just that simple, huh? Let's not make the same mistake as Bush made when he was in office, when he didn't take in consideration wise military tactics when he first went over to Iraq and realized they didn't have weapons of mass destruction. It wasn't mission accomplished. And oops, now I got to take that money, take money overseas to try to rebuild Iraq and try to be allies with these people. We apologize. We sorry for bombing your city or your country. You know, we thought you had weapons of mass destruction. Now they have to fix it. So, yeah. So let's not make the same mistake as Bush. Well, not us, you know, not me being inclusive. Let you all not make the same mistake as Bush as far as Bachman and Santorum and the rest of the Republican Party who agree with their viewpoints. Let's not make the same mistake, because it won't be no exit strategy in Iran. It won't be no pulling out with Iran. Iran won't stop until America is obliterated. Iran won't stop one until this country is wiped off the map. So it won't be no stopping. It won't be no exit in this situation. Now, that was, of course, fortunate enough with Iraq to have an exit. But with Iran, it's to the death. It's not, you know, two countries go to war and one country wins, the other one left with a tail between their legs but still standing. Now, in this case, it's two countries go to war, one of them not going to exist no more, and the other one still standing. That's how it's going to be with going to war with Iran. It's not no, oh, we going to wipe you, or we going to cripple you or hurt you real bad, but let you still exist. No, it's we going to completely obliterate you. We're going to completely wipe you off the map to make sure you don't get an opportunity to gain revenge, and to make sure you don't be able to get the opportunity to rebuild yourself. So that's why it's extremely risky going to war with Iran. But of course, you got the hard-headed, foolish folks that don't listen. They only just trying to get their name in the history books. They only trying to get popularity and go to war with Iran, and you're going to see nukes fly all over America, and who's to blame? The Republicans. Who's to blame? So, okay, on it in. Also, the other thing was, I just want to make one more point on it before I switch to Obama, as far as the prophecy on his end. But the other thing, like I said, with Iran, I think I pretty much covered everything. Oh, yeah, that was the other thing. Thanks, Holy Spirit. But, also, what they also need to take into consideration as far as going to war with Iran is consult the Secretary of Defense. That's his position. That's his job. He's supposed to help to come up with military strategies just as well as General Petraeus. They're supposed to call, come together, you know, Obama, General Petraeus, and the Secretary of Defense, and come up with a conclusion. Hey, what's best? It's really not Congress to decide. You know, Obama is considered the commander-in-chief. He decides the Secretary of Defense and the general, the war general. Everybody else are exempt. These are the three head leaders that decide about war tactics or strategy or conclusions and decisions when it comes to going to war. Everybody else out. They all sit in the room together. Lay it down. What do we have to do? Is this necessary? You know, is this relevant? If this is not relevant, we're not going to, you know, take that chance. But if it's absolutely necessary, we might have to take a risk. But going against Iran, also Russia, also China, because they are allies, because, like I said, China is manufacturing nuclear warheads and weapons for Iran. What did Iran get his military power from? What does Iran get his weapons? Who manufactures Iran weapons? What does it get his military power? Who's doing it for them? It ain't America. America did it for Saudi Arabia, but America didn't do it for Iran. Well, America provided some weapons to the Iraqi soldiers. But America didn't provide no weapons to Iran. or manufacture weapons for Iran. So who is it that's providing Iran's weapons and nukes? China, Russia, the allies of Iran are providing the weapons for Iran. China and Russia. So if China and Russia goes to war, if Iran goes to war, China and Russia are going to play a part because they are partners. They are an alliance. The same way, go to war with China. Russia going automatically. China goes to war, Russia goes to war. Automatic. Like I said, they like that old saying, two peas in a pot. Automatic. But Iran goes to war, and the Iranian president, Ahmadinejad, has favor from the UN. You know, he's highly respected from the UN because he makes a lot of points. If you hear Ahmadinejad talk, he makes a lot of valid points. He is intellectual. He's not as foolish or as dumb as a lot of politicians over here or the media make him seem. If you listen to him speak and talk, he talks with sense. He knows what he's talking about. It's just the wickedness within Congress, not all the congressmen, but some of them that's been in there for quite a while, is getting exposed from a so-called third party, since, you know, Iran would be considered a third world country. So getting exposed from a third party, and they don't like this, so, oh, he idiotic, he don't know what he's talking about, he a terrorist, he this, he that. But sitting there listening to him talk on different, watching different videos and interviews, the guy seemed like he got sense to me. So what is it? Is he exposing something? Is it because they don't want him to reveal something, or he revealing too much information, or what is the true reality of why he, you know, such a threat, such a terrorist? Because what it seemed like to me, and I'm not condoning Ahmadinejad, not supporting, but I'm saying, as far as calling it for what it is, for what I see. And for what I see is, he refuses to be bullied or mistreated like the Iraqis and like the Libyans. And that's what he told Bush, that he not going to take what the Iraqis took. He not going to take what they took in Afghanistan. He not going to take what they took in Libya. He not going to take it. He not going to stand for it. And that's why he is kind of provoking America, saying, I want you to mess with me. Please come. I mean, from watching Ahmadinejad and his, you know, speeches and his conversations and interviews, it's more like he's saying, please come over here. Please invade this country, please, so I can show you what I get. Because I got a lot of weapons that I'm proud of. I got a lot of weapons that I didn't pay for with this Arab money, you know, as some people nickname it. So it's like he's saying, please come over here, please, America, please come try me like y'all did with the rest of these folks, so I can show you I'm not afraid of you, so I can show you I'm not going. So if Ahmadinejad makes threats, it's because he wants it. He wants America. It's like a taunt. Come on. Come on over here. I want y'all to come infiltrate. Please come over here so I can deliver some gifts over there to your country. Some huge gifts, by the way. Not small. And it ain't, you know, it's going to be a major surprise. It's going to be an explosion of gifts. Not the type of explosion of you think it is as far as happiness, but fear and misery. So hopefully they're taking it in consideration. Secretary of Defense, General, the War General, and the Commander in Chief. Sit in the room, come to a conclusion. But I'm finna get ready to get on it in a sec as far as with Obama, what's gonna happen. The reason they gonna try to take him out. And like I said, remember, I hope y'all listening, pay attention, because y'all see I'm been telling the truth. Those you've been watching my channels and you seeing the news and stuff, and you seeing it's all connected. You see, the power of the Holy Spirit is real. Okay. But like I said, pretty much covered on it. And, you know, like I said, I'm a demon job wants it. Russia and China is connected with this guy, and Ahmadinejad has the support of the UN. He has the support of world leaders because he talk with a lot of sense, and he make a lot of valid points when he speak against this country. You know, they showed on a video, I saw a video where two U.S. ambassadors walked out of meeting at the UN. That was so unprofessional. It was so unprofessional, those ambassadors of this country did cause this country to lose even more respect. Even more respect. At least one of them could have got up there and spoke and addressed the concerns and issues of Ahmadinejad, had a little bit of debate and disputed what he was saying, but to just get up and walk out makes you seem like you're guilty. So that right there was, man, what in the world was on their mind? Okay, but since I got more time, I'm going to throw in something extra. The Spirit just dropped something in me to share as an add-on. Okay, now as far as on Obama end, okay, here's what's going to happen. Now, remember I said sitting in the room, Secretary of Defense, the War General, and Obama. Here's what's going to happen. Obama does not want to go to war with Iran. He does not. Obama knows the consequence. He knows if he goes to war with Iran and it be a major catastrophe that happens in his country, he is going to get the blame. He do not want to be responsible for over 10,000 casualties of troops nor of citizens in his country. So that's why Obama don't want to go to war with Iran. When it comes to bombing Iran, you notice a zip on Obama, like, no, I am not trying to go that way. Definitely not trying to go that direction. But, unfortunately, Obama more than likely is, like I said, going to win. It's not more than likely, it's most than likely, you know, but I know the correct way says more than likely. But I said, it's too much evidence, the revelation already came. I told y'all last time when he first stepped foot in a campaign, on his campaign trail, I already knew he was going to win when Hillary, let me see how to do this from my camera angle. Okay, yeah, this finger here, when Hillary was up this much and Obama was behind this far. As a matter of fact, I say more like this. And I was telling people, he going to win. They like, how in the world Obama going to win when look how far here Hillary up in a popular vote, this, this, that. Then all of a sudden, it switched, because I already knew, because I was matching up and looking at prophecy, and I saw a lot of things leaking up, and that's how I knew. So, but here, anyway, you know, back to the main thing, here's what's going to happen, all right? And so Obama don't want to go war with Iran because he already know the consequences. You know, major catastrophe happened during his term as far as going to war with Iran, it's going to be his fault. And he don't want to live with that guilt for the rest of his life. So, they are going to threaten his life. Yeah. Obama's life is going to be threatened to go to war with Iran. Okay? They're going to threaten to go to war. They're going to threaten his life to go to war with Iran. He's not going to do it. Because he know that the consequences are going to be devastating. So, because his refusal to go to war with Iran, and also the hatred of the people, the rioters, the protesters, because of his re-election, or see, leading up to his re-election anyways, is going to be hatred from within Congress and out of Congress, in and out. Not only, like I said, just right now, just outwardly, but it's going to be more inwardly. And all of the Republicans are going to be mostly like Judas, waiting to try to slit his throat at any time. Not saying that's how they're going to try to eliminate him. Quest is going to be all discreet, undercover, washing their hands like Pontius Pilate with Jesus. I washed my hands of this. I ain't have nothing to do with it. But, yeah, like I said, they're going to try to threaten his life. Obama going to refuse because he don't want that on his conscience of being responsible for over 10,000 casualties in and outside America involving the troops and the citizens. And they going to, you know, set it up for somebody to try to take them out. And then, like I said, Obama ain't going to die. You're not going to die. People going to think, oh no, they got him. And, you know, he's going to be resuscitated. And then when Obama get resurrected, that's when the devil is fully going to take over in him. Yeah. He's going to want full-fledged revenge. He's not going to care anymore. And that's when America is going to start to turn into the Titanic. It's already the Titanic now, but that's when, you know, like on a movie, it's when it's going to go this way. You know, when it was sinking, it was like slightly slanted. You know, I'm trying to match it. Yeah, about right there. It was slightly slanted, you know. And then when it started to fully sink, you know, I'm trying to match it with my camera, but y'all know what I'm trying to do. Then that's when it sat there a minute. And then, you know. But yeah, so you know, pretty much laid it out there, you know, just giving y'all a heads up. Yeah, that's it. Threaten his life, he gonna refuse. Somebody gonna boosh. Oh no, you know, protesters, you know, they already going insane in Oakland and Ohio and DC and all these other places. That's when the riots gonna break out. They gonna start breaking in stores. They gonna start doing them whiskey bottle bombs, I forgot what it's called, and yeah, they're gonna bomb DC, and they're gonna start going crazy all over the place. And then the Muslim brothers and sisters, the Jihad and Al Qaeda that is here amongst us, that's not wearing a native attire, it's gonna be suicide bombs and car bombers, and like I said, it's gonna start to get crazy, it's gonna start to go insane. But then, you know, he get resuscitated, it's going to level back out. Oh, he's okay. We can stop acting crazy and acting a fool. And that's when it's not going to get better. It's going to get worse because Obama going to want full-fledged revenge. And afterwards, yeah, okay. But anywho, I think I shared enough on it. I think I, you know, it's like some just came in me like, shut up, leave it at that. Leave it at that. Well, not shut up, but just be quiet. Leave it at that. It's like this, some, I don't know if Father just touched me. Shh, that's enough. You didn't share it too much for right now. Okay, so follow me, brother. I'm going to leave that alone. It just, I don't know, something just dropped in me. Just, that's enough. I don't know. People, I mean, this is happening while I'm recording. Like, wow, just some, just, that's enough. But, okay, one more topic I wanted to share before I wrap this up. You know, like I said, wow. But it just, something just popped up. But I guess that's all they want me to share, because something just blanked out. So all the information was there, and it just bling, doesn't know that's enough. I guess he, like, until they get fertilized, then more will get revealed to you. And being fertilized to the listeners and the viewers that's taking heed of what I'm saying. One last topic, you know, aside from politics and prophecy and the current events of the world is Tim Tebow. I wanted to talk on it just real briefly. Okay, here's the thing I don't get. Now, here's a country that is supposed to be predominantly Christian. This is supposed to be the most Christian nation in the world, on the entire planet. This is supposed to be the most Christian nation, okay? You know, this is the West. The West supposed to be mostly Christian. If you remember the Crusades, and you know, the Muslims and Christians or Catholics were battling it out, and the Christians took over the West, the Muslims took over the East. So a football player who founding fathers and forefathers of this country that's on Mount Rushmore mostly was Christian. Then one of them was atheist, and that was Benjamin Franklin. Or I could be wrong, but if I'm not mistaken, it was Ben. One of the, you know, a football player honoring the religion and faith of his forefathers and the founding fathers of his country gets made fun of because of his Christian faith. So we're sitting here watching the news media making fun of him for praying on the football field and all that, seeing his fellow peers or other football players making fun of him, you know, praying and acknowledging God on the football field. And, you know, it's in the newspapers and some more, and on SNL, Saturday Night Live, they made fun of him for acknowledging Jesus and praying on the football field. So that right there doesn't make sense. How does a athlete who is a Christian in a supposed to be Christian country gets made fun of for acknowledging the faith of his forefathers? I'm trying to figure that one out. You know, it's like, how did this country was supposed to be built off biblical principles? It's supposed to be built off biblical principles, and here's this football player, and he'll say, okay, computer died down. Here's this football player that gets made fun of because of his faith that this country is supposed to be built around. Because, you know, in the First Amendment, it says freedom of religion. Because, you know, that was the whole point of Christopher Columbus and the Catholics. They was trying to find a place to express their religion freely. Because in Rome, at one point, Christians was getting burnt alive and crucified and fed to lions, etc., for practicing Christianity. And not only Rome, but other parts of the world where Christianity is forbidden. Just like modern day society today in the East, if you practice Christianity, you got the Crusades taking place as I speak. A lot of Christian homes and families have been attacked by Muslims, extremist Muslims, that's, you know, that's a true believer, I guess, and they have been attacking Christian families and believers over in the East. So, anywho, it just don't make sense to me. So there's just something right there, you know, I just wanted to be brief and share that I guess Obama was right in his inauguration address when he said this is no longer a Christian nation. He says a nation of Muslim, Hindus, and Jews, etc. So my thing is, if Tim Tebow was opening the Quran and he started quoting some Quran verses, would the media make fun of that, or would they leave him alone? Because the faith, the religion he's practicing and acknowledging is the religion of this nation. It's supposed to be the most Christian nation, but they made fun of it. So I wonder if he opened up a Quran or whatnot and started acknowledging that, would that be a problem? Then, he's a terrorist then, but when he acknowledged Christianity, he's a joke. But he started reading the Quran, he's a terrorist. You can't win for lose in this country, boy. You can't win for lose, man. Alright, folks, but I just wanted to, you know, do a bundle. I thought I was going to do the Tim Tebow thing separate, but I go ahead. I figured I'd go and do it together. So I'll leave it at that. Let me go ahead and finish relaxing and get to some other things. So y'all know my motto, which is always in my heart to say, which is peace be unto you in Christ for life. Making sure to cross straight, but yeah.